Today we are on number 18 in the series on the Apostle Peter, and I've entitled it Tradition 2.0. Okay? Tradition 2.0. Today Christians do not give a second thought to our diets. We just eat whatever we want. We don't have to think about whether we can or cannot eat that. But that is not always so, and it was really thanks to the teaching of Jesus through the Apostle Peter that this came about to be so. We know from Mark chapter 7, the text that we are looking at today, the start of this revolution that Jesus began, telling the believers that they need not have dietary laws. And eventually that was also expressed in Acts chapter 10. Now the significance of it is this: it opens up the gospel to a lot of people. Can you imagine if the gospel today, the gospel of Jesus Christ, is restricted by the same dietary laws that have restricted the Jews? Okay. For example, if you become Christians, you cannot eat pork. Yeah. For many people, that will be extremely difficult, right? Or the Jews are not supposed to eat shellfish. You know, you cannot eat shellfish, you cannot eat prawns, you cannot eat crab. Tough being a Christian. or you cannot eat a fish unless it has 5 scales or more. If there are no scales on the fish, like a catfish, you cannot eat it. Okay. The Jews also have other customs, and from the look of your faces, you are not very familiar with Jewish customs and the food. You cannot take meat and milk in the same meal. So for example, if you order a pizza, it will always be a plain pizza. Or you can put vegetables on it, you can never have meat on top of the pizza because the pizza has cheese and that's made of from milk. So you cannot have meat and milk together in the same meal. You must have at least, I think, 6 hours in between or 12 hours in between the two or something like that. Okay. So when we abolish the dietary laws, it really opens up the gospel to the entire world. And while at the very beginning it was difficult for the Jews to think that I now no longer have to keep these dietary laws, yet we found that in the wisdom of God, that really opened the gospel up. Now, I think what we don't realize is this, that most religions today continue to have dietary laws. We seem to think that dietary laws are something unusual, but they are not at all. The Hindus have dietary laws, right? The Muslims have, for sure. The Buddhists also have. If you are a true Buddhist, you'll be vegetarian. You know, the only major religion that possibly might not have dietary laws, somewhat like the Christians, would be Taoism. But actually, Taoism has dietary laws too. They have the laws not concerning the animal types, but concerning what is yin and what is yang. The qi must be balanced. So it's actually a very complex dietary system. And then on certain months of the days of the month, you cannot eat certain stuff and all that. But it has a whole set of taboos that are not found in the other religions, and it's called feng shui. And so you find that the Christian faith has really gone out into the world on account of its ability to accept all kinds of diets. And that really started through the Apostle Peter. Well, how does this story in Mark chapter 7 goes? Well, first there was the issue of hand washing. There was some controversy about hand washing. And from the hand washing became the issue of food, because hand washing concerns the food that you eat. And then it was the issue of uncleanness. If you do not wash your hands, do the food that you eat therefore become unclean and they make you unclean? And then it goes to the subject of what goes in and what comes out of us. Okay, so this is what we are looking at today. Now let us take a look first at the first section, when the disciples failed to meet the expectations of the Pharisees, found in the first 5 verses of Mark chapter 7. One day, some Pharisees and teachers of religious law arrived from Jerusalem to see Jesus. They noticed that some of his disciples failed to follow the Jewish ritual of hand washing before eating. Now you notice the parenthesis, that's the explanation part by the gospel writer Mark. The Jews, especially the Pharisees, do not eat until they have poured water over their cupped hands as required by their ancient traditions. Similarly, they don't eat anything from the market until they immerse their hands in water. This is but one of the many traditions they have clung to, such as their ceremonial washing of cups, pitchers, and kettles. Okay. So they noticed that the disciples of Jesus failed to observe these traditions that the Jews typically observe. Most Jews observe, and especially the Pharisees, they are very punctilious in the observation of these rules. So the Pharisees and teachers of religious law ask him, "Why don't your disciples follow our age-old tradition? They eat without first performing the hand-washing ceremony." Now, what is the issue? Well, we are not told who these disciples were. We are told some of his disciples. It could be the 12 apostles themselves, or it could be the wider circle of disciples. But some washed their hands before they eat, and some did not. Well, at the very least, they noticed that some did not wash their hands in the ceremonial way. It wasn't an issue of hygiene. It was an issue of ceremony. Okay? So we do not know exactly who these disciples were. Now, there was a perceived failure on their part, that is, in the washing of hands. This was extrapolated from washing of their bodies and hands after contact with that which is unclean. It is found in Leviticus. In Leviticus, they are told that if you were to touch something that is unclean, ceremonially unclean, you need to wash your hands. In some cases, you need to wash your entire body. You need to immerse your entire body in water, and then you come out, and then you'll be clean after a day. And there are various cleansing customs. And so they extrapolated from that, and they say that, well, what if you go to the marketplace? You know, you don't know who you shake hands with, you don't know who you say hello to, you don't know what you touch, and so we'll assume that it is unclean. And if it is unclean, then the hands become unclean. Now, if the food is clean and the hands are unclean, then the unclean hands will touch the clean food and the food becomes unclean. Then if I eat it, I become unclean. Okay, so therefore, I have to cleanse my hands, go through a cleansing ceremony of my hands, so that my ceremonially clean hands would match my ceremonially clean food, so that when I eat it, I do not become unclean. Okay, so that is the sort of rationale and reasoning behind it. But this isn't found in the Old Testament. It was one of the Jewish customs. Now, the explanation in the parenthesis was the explanation to the Roman audience. The audience of Mark's gospel were Romans. The Apostle Peter was preaching to the Romans in Rome, and then John Mark was the one who copied all these things down, and so it's called Mark's gospel. Now, in the process of explaining to the people, he has to explain what the big issue is about, because the Romans don't have these customs about washing hands and all that, so they wouldn't know what the issue is about. So that portion there in brackets were the explanation of the evangelist Mark telling us what this is all about. Now, the Pharisees assumed that they were all required to follow tradition. They didn't ask Jesus, you know, should they, shouldn't they, simply ask why. Why didn't you do it? The assumption is that they should all do it. It was such an established custom that everybody was expected to do it. Now, if you fail to do it, you sort of have to admit, lower your head and say, yeah, I know I should have done it, but I was too lazy, there wasn't water around, or some other lame excuse, okay? But the assumption is that you're supposed to do it. And so they, in a sense, complained to Jesus about his disciples. Now, this is found today in the Mishnah. There's a whole section of the Mishnah that lays out for us the hand-washing ceremonies. The Mishnah is the parting point between Christianity and Judaism. You know, we share the same Old Testament, right? Judaism and Christianity share the same Old Testament. Where we depart is that Christians have the New Testament and Jews have the Mishnah. Okay, therein lies that parting point. So if you want to know where that parting point is, it is the two books, the New Testament and the Mishnah. That's actually the parting point between the two. Okay, and the Mishnah would outline for you all the washing ceremonies that are required. Now, what happened to Jesus is this. We need to understand that Jesus advocates a freedom that is offensive to the Jews. He says that there is no need to wash your hands. And what he was about to say was going to be very difficult for the Jews. Now, we are told in 1 Peter chapter 2 that Jesus is the stone that makes people stumble, the rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they do not obey God's word, so they meet the fate that was planned for them. But you are not like that, for you are a chosen people, you are royal priests, a holy nation, God's own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. This is one passage where Jesus was again a stumbling block. We talked about that some time back. And I think some of you were shocked by the understanding of what it means to be a stumbling block or not to be a stumbling block. Well, a stumbling block simply means, the image that is given to us simply means a stone or a block that you trip over. Now, you can trip over as you are moving towards God. So somebody tries to trip you up. He puts a trip wire, a stumbling block in front of you, and you trip and you fall, and that's not good. That stumbling block is not good. But if you are walking towards God, and there are all these marker stones, or curbside, so to speak, guarding you so that you won't trip, you won't fall out of it, you choose to wander around and you kick the curb. Now, there's nothing wrong with that stumbling block over there. The problem is the person walking out of the track. Okay, so the stumbling block in and of itself is neutral. It is where that block is placed that is the issue. And so Jesus Christ here is called the stumbling block. He's a stone of stumbling. And we talked about that some time ago, but just as a refresher and for some of us who were not here. So Jesus here was not trying to be inoffensive to the Jews. He didn't say, well, okay, since it doesn't really hurt to wash hands, okay, you guys, disciples, and all of you should just wash hands so that we don't offend these guys. He didn't do that. Instead, he decided to embark on a path that explains why it is quite unnecessary and in fact quite hypocritical for the Jews to be washing their hands and not do the more important things of God. So the reality of the problem of offense is this. Many times people who do not yet come to faith, they are pre-faith people, you know, there are people who have looked at Christians from the outside, and they have certain expectations of Christians, rightly or wrongly. They have formed certain expectations. They might think perhaps that, Christians are people, when they drive, they never honk at other people. You know, or Christians, when they are on the MRT, they will always stand up and give their seat to other people. You know, or Christians are people who never lose their temper. You know, things like that. Okay? And these are all good things, not that they are bad things. And then if they meet up with a Christian who sort of fails in their expectation, they may become very disappointed. Okay, or sometimes people who are new to the faith. So the person who hasn't known Christ yet eventually comes to faith in Christ, and they have all these expectations of themselves and of the people around them. And some of these expectations are not exactly right. Some things are good, some things are kind of self-created restrictions. So Jesus was telling the Pharisees that your rules about this hand washing is really your own. It didn't come from the Word of God at all. And if you are offended, well, sort of, that really cannot be helped. I think by now many of you are aware that we have a core value here at the Well, and we call it BARE, B-A-R-E, to be biblical, to be authentic, to be relevant, and to be relevant and to be effective. And today we are sort of touching on this point about being biblical. And to be biblical means that we want to affirm where Scripture affirms and silence where Scripture is silent. In other words, we do not want to make the mistake of the Pharisees. We do not want to create our own rules. Okay, and then expect everybody else to comply with our rules. If it is in the Word of God, it is there. If it is not in the Word of God, it is not there. We don't make them. Okay, so that is an important principle to adhere to. Jesus Christ replied the Pharisees by saying this, "You hypocrites! Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you, for he wrote, 'These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship is a farce, for they teach man-made ideas as commands from God.'" And that is the point. Teaching man-made ideas as commands from God. "For you ignore God's law and substitute your own tradition." Okay. So then he said, "You skillfully sidestep God's law in order to hold on to your own tradition. For instance, Moses gave you this law from God, 'Honor your father and mother,' and anyone who speaks disrespectfully of father or mother must be put to death. But you say it is all right for people to say to their parents, 'Sorry, I can't help you, for I have vowed to give to God what I would have given to you.' In this way, you let them disregard their needy parents. So you cancel the word of God in order to hand down your own tradition. And this is only one example among many others. You see, there are some laws in Scripture that people don't quite like. And in the Old Testament, there are many of these. And one of them is that, you know, if you curse your father and mother, or if you strike your father and mother, you know, you need to be put to death. Okay? So you know how the Mishnah interprets it? Well, it says that it's true. If you strike your father and mother, you must be hauled to the presence of the elders, and you will be tried, and then if found guilty, you will be stoned to death. So they say, well, first of all, it means that this person who strikes the father and mother must not be lame. Because if they are lame, they cannot be hauled to court. So it must not be lame. The person who strikes the father and mother must be able to defend himself verbally. Otherwise, he cannot argue his own case. You know, so they begin to create all kinds of conditions so that it's impossible to carry out a law. Okay. They created all these exceptions so that it never happens anyway. So Jesus is saying, are you serious about God's word? If there is one law that you don't really quite like, you qualify it to death until that law doesn't count anymore. Okay? And then the things that you think you can do and you like to do, you pile on to it and you add on to it. And you make it bigger and larger than what it really is. So Jesus Christ had three issues with the Pharisees. You look at what he says. He started by saying, you hypocrites. So he has an issue with their hypocrisy, right? That's the first issue. And the second issue is that there are inconvenient commands. Certain commands are inconvenient, and because they're inconvenient, they do them away. And thirdly, there's the issue of the fence, which we'll talk about shortly. Now, what is hypocrisy? Hypocrisy is a deceptive self-righteousness expressed by condemning in others what we also do, but in secret or through self-justification. Okay. Now, what is hypocrisy is very important because in today's world, the word hypocrite is thrown about all the time. And the people most accused of hypocrisy are Christians. Okay. And that is the reality. Christians are called hypocrites all the time. But that is because, first of all, they either don't understand the meaning of hypocrisy or they're a little bit off somewhere. So there has to be a deceptive self-righteousness, meaning that a person must be saying, I'm right, you're wrong, in the process. And then he must also be doing the same thing at the same time. So while I say don't steal, I'm a bigger thief. You know, that's being hypocritical. And then, of course, when I do that, I'm doing my stealing in secret, right? So there's a secrecy involved. There is also self-justification. Why do I tell you not to steal and I'm stealing? In my own mind, I'll be justifying myself, because, you know, my family needs it, my this needs it, my mom is sick, my dad is lame, my children need to go to school. And so I begin to justify all this stuff myself. Okay, and all these things make up what comprises hypocrisy. Now, hypocrisy is not simple inconsistency, because we will always be inconsistent. There will never be a single human being on the face of the earth who is consistent. If hypocrisy is inconsistency, then everybody is a hypocrite, then the word has no meaning, right? So do parents tell their kids, don't lie, then they turn around and they lie, right? I mean, how many parents don't lie, honestly? Okay, and they teach their kids, don't lie, but that's inconsistent. And does that therefore make the parent a hypocrite? Does that therefore mean that the parent cannot teach the child, don't tell lies? Not necessarily. Inconsistency does not always mean hypocrisy. There was not too long ago, several years ago now actually, there was a New York governor who later became the attorney general and you know, the chief prosecutor of New York City. And so he was on this campaign of closing down all the brothels, you know, all these social escort services. And he was very vigorous at it. He busted businesses, he hounded them down and all that. And of course, eventually he was found to have paid large sums of money to a lover through an escort service himself. And some of you know who I'm talking about. Originally, I put his name there, I decided to take his name out. And maybe don't want to embarrass him any further. Okay, and so what happened was that, well, he was considered a hypocrite. He was a hypocrite because there he was arresting all these madams and prostitutes and Johns, and he was a John himself. A John meaning a patron, just in case you don't know. That's a term that's used for a patron of prostitutes, is a John. Okay. There's a certain insidiousness about hypocrisy that Jesus condemns. Why is that so? You see, hypocrisy does not allow us to know our own fault. Because the hypocrite justifies himself. He's saying, I'm okay, the other person is not. And therefore, the hypocrite will never come to repentance because he can never see his own fault. And therefore, hypocrisy needs to be confronted. Now, there is hypocrisy among conservative people. Conservative as a whole. It can be Christians, non-Christians, but more or less political, economic conservatives. And there is a tendency to create new laws. Conservatives tend to multiply rules and regulations. Okay? But there is a liberal hypocrisy as well. Liberals create their own laws and pretend that they are not laws. For example, you will hear people say that there's no such thing as something that is absolute. Everything is relative. Right and wrong is all relative. So I say, okay. So your rule that right and wrong is relative is also relative. So how can you have one absolute rule saying that nothing is absolute? So they create their own rules. And they create their own rules and they think that they are fully justified in creating this rule that doesn't apply to them, but applies to everybody else. Correct? And nothing is absolute except my law. My law is exempt from that consideration. Okay? So I think liberals also have their own hypocrisy. It's just that they don't see it. And that is the nature of hypocrisy. You cannot see it yourself. You look at the thing and it looks perfectly sensible to you. It takes somebody from the outside to say, hey, but this is kind of self-contradictory, isn't it? You see, Jesus Christ says this, that you skillfully sidestep God's law in order to hold on to your own tradition. And so that was an inconvenient command. So they sidestep it. Okay? And therefore, you cancel the word of God in order to hand down your own tradition. And then the third thing that Jesus condemns is the philosophy of the fence. Now, the Jews used to say this, the Pharisees, say that here is the law of God, and we don't want to transgress the law of God. Now, how can we make sure that we don't break God's law? So out of, so to speak, sincerity, they say, we're going to create another set of laws so that it's like a double layer fence, you know, so that if you cross the first fence, you don't cross the second fence. So God's law is that final fence, that final keep, that final frontier. And so we're going to build a fence around God's laws. And therefore, in that way, God's laws would not be broken. Now, while it may be logical to some extent, it is a wrong analogy. If you use a wrong analogy and you sort of hang everything on that wrong analogy, then everything falls apart. Because they are saying that we are creating something in order that God's law would not be broken. But in reality, they are multiplying the number of laws that God did not intend in the first place. And so that analogy doesn't work. I know when I was young, there was an analogy that, you know, you stay far away from the cliff. You don't sort of go as near to the cliff as possible and say, well, am I sinning yet? Am I sinning yet? Am I sinning yet? And whoops, you know, you sort of fall in. So you don't do that. You go to the far end, you go to the safe end. But that's also a false analogy. Because when Jesus walked this earth, he had as much problems with the Pharisees, who were the hyper-conservatives, as much as he had, or in fact, more than people who were sinners on the other end of the spectrum. Instead, the Bible tells us to rightly divide the word of truth, and that is the analogy given to us in Scripture. So it is like a bridge. So when you're walking on a bridge, you don't go more to the left or more to the right. You sort of stick right in the center. Okay. And that is because you're on the bridge. And that's the analogy that is sound in Scripture. So Jesus opposes the idea of creating a fence around the law of God. Let me give you an example in our modern day situation. You know, we are told that women should be dressed decently. And so, okay, what does that mean? Well, some people extrapolate that to say that to be decent means that women should keep long hair. Okay, I do not know how the connection comes about, but it does. Okay, or some people say therefore they should have a scarf over their head, or should have a veil, you know, or should have a wear a hat or something like that. You know, I've been to churches in America where women still wear hats, and it's not that I mind it, but they tend to block the view. You know, so and so it's a little bit hard to duck in between the hats to look at the preacher. Okay, but we extrapolate. We start somewhere, they should be decent, and then we say, decent means this, and decent means that. And then we begin a whole set of rules, rather than stick to just the principle itself. Okay, or for men to dress properly means that they must wear a tie, for example. You know, and so they say, well, if you don't wear a tie, you know, you're not properly dressed and all that. When you come to church, you must do this or that. Well, maybe not so bad in Singapore because it's so hot, you know, so almost impossible to demand that everybody wears a tie. But still, stuff like that happens. In fact, for some places where they say everybody must, worship leaders must all wear a coat and tie, and then I'll point to them and say, you know, in the mission field, that guy wears a sarong and a singlet and he's leading worship and it's all right. You know, I'm not saying that I want to do that, but why do we create these additional rules? Well, dress properly, that's it, whatever that means. I don't think we want to set rules. Or example is this, the Bible is clear that we should not be drunk. The drunkenness is not good. And so some say that therefore you should be a teetotaler. You know, you should drink tea and nothing else. Okay, total abstinence. You know, among conservative Christians, there is a tradition to abstain from alcohol, and that's fine. But if you were to look at the entire Christian tradition, there is no call to abstain from alcohol. There was never such a call in Europe. The only point in the whole of Christian history when Christians said to abstain from alcohol was in America during the abolition period, you know, where they say to try to abolish alcohol. And of course, if you all know what happened, the ban actually came about. They stopped alcohol sales, purchases, and manufacturing, and then it created people at Al Capone in Chicago, where they made millions, if not billions, of dollars selling bootleg liquor and all that kind of stuff. Okay. So it has never been in Christian tradition to abstain totally from alcohol. Now, just to give you perspective, if you were to go to Pakistan, a Muslim country like Pakistan, the alcohol cannot be sold or bought freely. Okay, but you can still buy alcohol. Who can buy alcohol? The pastor can buy alcohol. The pastor of a church or a Christian can buy alcohol. So my job is, I'm a pastor, I'm registered as a pastor, I can therefore buy alcohol. Because I'm not under Muslim law. Muslim law says cannot take alcohol. Christians do not prohibit that. And the Muslims recognize that Christians had never prohibited alcohol. And so they allow Christians to buy alcohol, and Muslims cannot buy. Okay, so of course then Christians can run a side business, right? But the point is this. The point is that the Bible does not at any point prohibit the use of alcohol. It does prohibit drunkenness. Okay. So when we want to create a fence around the law of God, it sounds right, but it's actually not quite right. We're actually going beyond what Scripture tells us. But there are some people who choose not to drink, and that's perfectly fine. You know, President George W. Bush was an alcoholic. He was a recovering alcoholic. And after he became a Christian, he decided that he cannot touch alcohol. And that's for him. He's not saying this is a rule for everybody. He says, for me, I'm not going to touch alcohol. So like when he went to England on diplomatic trips and all that, of course, the English must go to the pub, right? So he'll hold a big mug of beer, but he won't drink it. You know, he'll take photo with a big mug of beer, but he wouldn't drink it. Okay, and I respect that. You know, the fact that he doesn't drink doesn't mean that nobody else can. Okay, for him, it wasn't good because he is a recovered alcoholic. He doesn't know where he's going to stop if he starts. So he says, I abstain from it totally. And so we should also respect people who abstain. Okay, and we do not want to trip people up. And for this reason, many times in our Holy Communion, we serve grape juice rather than wine, because some people are recovering alcoholics, you know. And the minute they take a sip of the wine, if it's real wine, they sort of start craving all over again. So we do not want to get them into this trouble. Okay, now, Jesus' instruction to the public was this. He says, he called to the crowd, he said, come and hear, all of you listen and try to understand. It's not what goes into your body that defiles you. You are defiled by what comes out from your heart. So we have that freedom from dietary laws. Jesus frees them from the ceremonial hand-washing rules of the Pharisees, and he also prepares them for the way, for the abrogation of the dietary laws. That eventually the laws will be done away with. And